Assalamu alaikum. This presentation is on rotation flaps and its applications in the head and neck reconstruction. We'll go through the design and the technique. As the name implies, the rotation flaps are pivotal flaps. They are usually random pattern flaps, and they are usually utilized to fill up a triangular defect or a defect that can be made into a triangular shape. Like if you start with a circular or a square or elliptical lesion, you can always draw a triangle around that lesion, and this would ease the mobilization of the flap into the defect and eases the tension on the suture line. The movement of the flap into the defect is of rotation pattern. It is best to have the base of the flap facing medially and downwards, and that would give the best possible vascularity in the face and also helps with the lymphatic drainage. Designing the flap starts by drawing an isosceles triangle around the defect. The isosceles triangle would have a base very close to the defect itself. If the diameter of the defect is X, then the base should be a little bit more than X. The height of this triangle should be about 2.5x, so the ultimate ratio between the height and the base of the triangle would be more than 2 to 1. The angles at the base would be about 75 degrees, and they would meet in a 30 degrees angle at the apex. And from there, you can start extending a curvilinear line that should measure about 6 times X, up to 8 and down to 5 or so if that is necessary. Once you removed the lesion and incised the curvilinear line, the flap can be mobilized into the defect. But you would see while mobilizing this that you have excess tissue here at the base of the curvilinear incision. And you can draw a Barrow's triangle, equilateral triangle, with its base about half an X, and this should facilitate the closure of the wound with no tension and no dog ear deformity. One alternative to excising Barrow's triangles, if you don't want to discard with viable tissue, is to have a back cut at the other end of the curvilinear line. So rather than excising the Barrow's triangle, you make a back cut here, making sure that you are not compromising the blood supply of the flap that goes from the base. Once you have the back cut in place, the flap can be mobilized easier into the defect itself. The defect that's going to be formed by mobilizing the flap away from the back cut would usually be closed in a V to Y type of reconstruction. There are several advantages for the rotation flaps. The blood supply is usually reliable because you have a wide base in relation to the height of the flap. You end up with only two sides to suture, so it's easier to try and align these two lines to relax skin tension lines. And if you have enough tissues on both sides of the defect, you can have two of these rotation flaps, like in the scalp, for example. And as you can see here, you can either have a Barrow's triangle or you can have a V to Y closure to the back cut of the flap. It can be used in several sides of the head and neck, including the tip of the nose and the nasal dorsum, where you can design a big flap after removing this lesion, extending from the glabella all the way down to the defect. You can also have a back cut in the glabella, so you end up with an inverted V-like incision in the glabella area that can be closed in a straight line. This large flap, because of the sweeping arc of the rotation, can then be mobilized to fill up the defect and the secondary defect created by the back cut will be closed in a straight line. Once you have the tip of the flap in the right position, this triangular defect, secondary defect, can be closed in a V to Y or a straight line closure. The other area in the nose where you can use rotation flaps are the upper third of the nose to one side, or you can have a curvilinear, almost horizontal incision, excise the lesion and mobilize this flap into position, and you can have either a back cut or a small Burrows triangle to it. And one can use bilateral rotation flaps to reconstruct a large lesion, say in the scalp, for example, or a lesion that has limited tissues only to one side of the lesion and you want to recruit tissues from both sides of it, or if the lesion is strictly in the midline and you want to maintain some symmetry by having recruiting tissues from the either sides of the defect. In this example, where you can have a circular defect transformed into a Z reconstruction by having two rotation flaps in opposite directions on either side of the defect. Once this reconstruction is sutured, you would see a Z rather than an O, or you can transform a circular or a triangular defect by bilateral rotation flaps into a T. In the case of bilateral rotation flaps, recruited from the either sides of the defect but going in opposite directions, you will end up with an O to Z type of reconstruction. So you draw the two flaps on the opposite directions on both sides, and because you are using two flaps rather than one, you can have the curvilinear line extending about 3 times to 2.5 times the diameter of the defect. Once the flaps are created and elevated, they can now be mobilized to meet in the midline of the defect. And once this is sutured, you will see a Z rather than an O. So that's the final closure. But when the bilateral rotation flaps are recruited from the same side of the lesion, you end up with a configuration of an O or an A to T rather than an O to Z. Here you are mobilizing the two rotation flaps to the midline, and that's a T type of reconstruction. And a similar situation here, where you want to reconstruct a defect by bilateral rotation flaps from the same side. Both flaps would meet up in the midline, and the reconstruction would take again the form of a T rather than a Z if the flaps are taken from opposite directions. It's important here to keep the line of the lip with minimal distortion. That's why you choose the A to T type of reconstruction. By this, we come to the end of this presentation on rotation flaps, the dimensions, the technique, and the applications. Assalamu alaikum.